The Project Level Early Warning Interest Group really spans a whole host of different kinds of topics, from case studies to tool showcases to broader discussions of where early warning sits within broader concepts such as disaster risk reduction and resilience. This particular meeting is a little bit of a different kind of case study, looking at a resilience program that has an early warning component in Somalia. And what makes it a little bit different from some of the other case studies that we've encountered over some of our previous meetings is that this project is just getting off the ground. So whereas a lot of the case studies that we've looked at have looked have focused on project level early warning elements that are underway or have finished and are kind of looking reflectively at the work that has been done and lessons that have come from it, as well as good practice, this particular project is just beginning. And so they are at the early stages of development of their early warning tools and community capacity strengthening around those tools. So it puts us at a little bit of an interesting, at a really nice point to be able to see what the project is thinking and how they've started to integrate this element and maybe bring some of our own experiences with using this element in different contexts to bear to provide some further ideas or guidance for how they might consider proceeding. So it looks like, Jean, you have a captive audience in that you are, of those of us in attendance so far, you are the expert on working on the ground in Somalia. It looks like we've got a lot to learn from you there. And that there is at least some familiarity within the group as to the concept of resilience. So I think people will be very interested to hear what you have to say about the project that you're working on within Somalia broadly, as well as how you're integrating early warning with the broader concept of resilience. So whenever you are ready to go, go ahead and begin the presentation. And we'll ask that if you please hold your questions until the end of the presentation, we'll have plenty of time for Q&A. So go ahead, Jean, whenever you're ready.
And also, if you have questions during the presentation, feel free to type them in the chat box, and we'll save them for the end.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. First of all, really, I want to thank you guys for giving me these opportunities of talking a little bit about our project, actually our program, and also to being able to have a discussion with you. As you said, the early warning system of the project is getting off the ground, not the project per se. The project started in 2013, but the community component of the early warning is taking off now. Let me maybe start with the presentation, if I understand how to do it. Yes, okay. I see that there is not a lot of familiarity with Somalia. So allow me to start with a brief description of what's going on in Somalia in terms of humanitarian needs and humanitarian assistance that is going on there. Also because, as you will see, resilience need to be very much targeted to the context you are looking at. You should see on your screens, I hope so, the map of Somalia which comes from OCHA, actually, which states that 3 million people are in need in Somalia, with a vast majority of these people concentrated in the southern and central region of the country. Somalia, as you of course know, is a failed state. In 1994, a civil war started in the country, and since then, the state structures, the authorities of the formal authorities of the countries, have been either under pressure or even non-existing. At the moment, there is a government, but this government has a weak grasp on the ground in Somalia, even if they are trying to expand their control of the country, both in terms of actually military control of some areas, but also in terms of expansion of the institutions that they are controlling. Somalia undergoes a series of different shocks: droughts, floods, other natural hazards. This year, there is a risk that El Niño will hit again, and then I'm sorry if I talk like this, but I'm also trying to read the chat at the same time. So if there is something that comes out, please write it down. So El Niño might have some impact in Somalia, but you might remember the 2011 drought, which heavily affected Somalia, especially the vulnerable population of south and central regions of Somalia. Somalia, of course, is hosting one of the most well-known terrorist groups in the world, Al-Shabaab, affiliated with Al-Qaeda, probably trying to establish some links at the moment with ISIL. This, of course, has a direct impact in the humanitarian programming because, if nothing, it restricts the access to many locations. Within the 3 million people in need, which I mentioned before, over 700,000 are in acute food insecurity, again, mostly in the central and southern regions of the country. 2.3 are food insecure. So if 700,000 are acutely food insecure, over 2 million people are food insecure. So as you see, the level of vulnerability is extremely high, also because Somalia is hosting over 1 million IDPs. This number, it's quite astonishing, and the number of displaced people probably is going to grow this year because of the Yemen crisis. I will mention it later, but anyway, the Yemen crisis is forcing people to return to Somalia. And you have to consider that there are over 250,000 Somali citizens living in Yemen. And also because of the policies that the Kenyan government is trying to implement, which aim at the closure of the refugee camps of Kakuma and most of everything of Dadaab. So we expect to have a total of between 60,000 to 100,000 returnees within 2016, so within next year. This is the context. Why I was describing the Somalia context, first of all, because I think it's important to give an impression on where we are working to people that, as I see from the survey, don't have a great familiarity with the country, but also because I would say that the first principle in resilience programming is that the context matters. In particular, it matters in terms of the shocks that the context can produce. In fact, we really argue that the resilience activities need to be built up around the specificities, the attributes of the context you are looking at. Let me talk now a little bit about the program, of course, very quickly. If then you have more questions, I will be happy to answer. First of all, we are talking about a multi-year program. This multi-year program starts in 2013, will finish at the end of 2017. I think this is another very important principle for resilience programming, which is the opportunity, the possibility to work over a longer period of time compared to the traditional humanitarian programs, which normally are 6 months to 1 year long projects. Another characteristic of the project is that it's multi-sector. We are looking in particular at WASH, shelter, food security and livelihood, and also some community resilience activities, which aim at building up the resilience at community level. Again, this is another very important attribution, I would say, of a resilience program, because resilience cannot be limited to one single sector, but really encompasses different aspects of the system that you are looking at. Third point, it's the fact that the project is community-based. It's community-based because the systems we are looking at are mostly households and communities. And therefore, if you want to define resilience at very specifically, and if you want to link up the definition of resilience that we have to the specific context, we have to go through an intensive process of community inclusion. Other facts about the BRICS program. I was mentioning the fact that it's a multi-year project, 4 years. I also mentioned the fact that it's a consortium formed by 5 members. I would say that the consortium approach for the NGO is particularly important because it allows to reach economy of scale that otherwise would not be reached. The scale that we are working at with the medium and long-term activities. At the moment, we are targeting 98 single communities in 7 regions and 21 districts in the southern and central regions of Somalia. This number will probably increase in the next few months. In terms of beneficiaries, we are targeting over 30,000 households, which means over 200,000 individual beneficiaries through medium and long-term interventions, but also at the same time, we are also looking at over 50, we looked actually in 2014 to over 50,000 households through emergency interventions. Probably we will reach another 60,000 this year through emergency interventions. We are also very much attentive to gender balance in our targeting, so at least 50% of the targeted beneficiaries are women. Let me just give you an hint also on the size in terms of the budget that we have. We are looking at around $70 million US dollars for the 4 year programs, which again allow us to work on scale in the places that we are, in the communities actually that we are targeting. I also see that there is a familiarity with the concept of resilience, some familiarities on the concept of resilience. Therefore, I'm not going into the definition of resilience. What I want to point out is that the traditional way to do resilience programming it's a chronological approach if you want. First, you go into emergency, then you move into relief, and finally, you develop developmental approaches, development projects. Now, through resilience, basically, well, something like that, through resilience, we don't keep this temporal approach. We work within what we call the continuum, where the three different aspects happen at the same time. This approach, which probably has been used in many other places, is quite new for Somalia, where the emergency and the relief approaches were following one after the other, but they were not coming at the same time. As we recognize the complexity of the system and therefore the necessity to work at the same time at the three level in order to deal with structural vulnerability and also short-term emergencies. And actually, the early warning system linked to the early warning action, it's a fundamental component of the program because it allows us to deal with the short-term emergencies, to the shocks that often happen in Somalia. This said, let me talk a little bit more in detail about the early warning, early action system that we are trying to develop. Again, I don't want to go into a specific definition of resilience or even academic definition. I just want to remind you that normally resilience is decomposed into three different aspects, which is absorption capacity, absorptive capacities, sorry, adaptive capacities, and transformative capacities. Now, the adaptive capacity is the capacity of the system to adapt itself to the shocks that are happening, and therefore to the changing situation. The transformative capacities of the system are it's even deeper, it's the capacity of the system to transform itself, to change itself, to mutate. But it's equally important to look at the absorptive capacities. We believe that it's equally important to look at the absorptive capacities of the system, in our case of the households and of the communities. And by absorptive capacities, basically we mean the capacities of the communities and of the households to absorb the effect of the shock without decreasing their level of well-being. And this is exactly what we are trying to do. When a shock happens, we intervene in order to avoid the level of well-being to drop down. We do this in two ways, basically. The first of all, it's an operative pillar, which is called IRF, which is an emergency facility, if you want. And the second one is the community-level early warning system. I'm going to describe the two pillars. I just want to point out that the operative pillar, the IRF, is fully ongoing, you will see, whereas the community level is as Laura was mentioning before, it's taking off the ground this week, this month. Basically, we will have it finally set up by the end of the year, I would say. Let's talk first about the operative pillar, which is the IRF. IRF stands for Internal Relief Facilities, and it's basically the crisis modifier that we are using. Basically, it is a founding mechanism which is designed, which is created to provide targeted and timely responses at local level before the consequences of the crisis start destabilizing the livelihood or the well-being of the communities. On the right side of the slide, you can see a map of the locations where we intervened in 2014 with the IRF, therefore with emergency interventions. Basically, the response that we designed last year was mostly driven by two shocks. The first one was a displacement movement due to basically a military offensive done by AMISOM in cooperation with the Somali army. And the second one, it was some pockets of droughts and some floods, which happens towards the end of 2014. In practice, the IRF looks in particular into five emergency sectors, which are health, wash, nutrition, shelter, mostly shelter through NFIs, and also emergency food security and livelihood, again, mostly done through cash transfers, both conditional and unconditional. The IRF, basically, the activation of the IRF is based on FSMU and the humanitarian country team triggers. I think it's worthwhile to just stop ourselves a moment here and discuss a little bit about these indicators. As you know, as you might know actually, the 2011 drought basically resulted in a huge humanitarian crisis. Basically, it resulted in a famine. The fact that the humanitarian community in the Horn of Africa realizes is that the problem at that time, it was not the lack of information. We knew that this thing was coming. It was the link between the information and the activation of activities. Basically, what happened is that the reaction to this crisis basically started after a few months, whereas the information were there. Therefore, under the lead of DFID, FSNU, which is a spin-off of FAO, designed through a consultative process to which we also participated, a series of trigger that basically will be used to identify a crisis and also to anticipate the response, to anticipate, sorry, the activation of the response. And that's why it's linked to the humanitarian country theme, which is basically the group of donors, UN, and some NGOs, a representation from NGOs, which are the ones that take decision on how to use the funds. Now, each trigger basically it's monitored at district level on a monthly basis, and the progression should tell us a few information on how to intervene. You see that they are looking to five macro areas, which are climate, population movements, nutrition, health, and market. Just to give you an example, in terms of population movement, they look at the percentage of increase in
Looks like Jean got dropped for a second there. So Jean, are you back with us now?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Okay. So I was just giving you some examples on how these triggers are operationalized, basically. Now this system of triggers, it's based on a thorough collection of information in the field. The point is that it's not yet operative. It's not yet operative. Despite the architecture, it's there and it's well established. We still don't have information about the progression of the indicators. This doesn't mean that we are not doing our emergency interventions. In fact, within the IRF, we adopted the same indicators, but partially we collect them, partially we double-check our information with other sources of information, such as OCHA, UNHCR, and other different bodies that provide information sharing in Somalia. For example, we are starting in these days to response to the Yemeni emergency that I was mentioning before. So we are basically adopting the same indicator and the same trigger that the FSNU is proposing, which is population movement, in particular as trigger number of displaced population. But we had to collect ourselves the information through the direct presence of the organization in the field, both in Puntland and Somaliland, which are the harbors of arrival of the returnees from Kenya and from the local offices in South Central Somalia, which are the places where these people, after having spent a few days in the reception center in Bosaso and in Berbera, they move. And also by cross-checking this information with different sources of information, again, OCHA and in this case in particular UNHCR. This allowed us, for instance, to identify several thousands of people that have been displaced, together with other pockets of displacement due to specific natural hazard, for example, floods, which displaced over 7,000 people, yes, in three IDP camps in the central region of Somalia. Basically, the use of these indicators through the data collection that the single members of BRICS have cross-checked with the different sources of information allowed us to activate at the beginning of June, so just a few days ago, a response worth more than 5 million British pounds for over, if I'm not wrong, 60,000 households. If you make 60,000 times 7, you will have the total number of beneficiaries that we are reaching, but it's around 350,000-400,000 people that we are targeting for the next few months. Oops. I already basically a little bit talked about this slide, but this is basically how the activation mechanism work. I was saying that most of the information come from the presence of the organization in the field, and so they can come directly from the communities or through the direct collection of data, which for us is fully digitalized. And it's cross-checked with the different sources of information in Somalia, which are really several. Here I'm just in the little circle, maybe it's so small, but you can see a few. OCHA, SWOLIM, PewSnet, FSMU are just a few examples of them, probably among the most reliable ones. So once the information is basically reached us, we basically couple the information that we have with the triggers through a thorough analysis of this information. And together with DFID, which is our main donors for this, we take an activation decision, which has happened a few days ago for this last IRF. This activation decision brings to an early action activation, so for the real implementation of the project. This is, if you want later, I can even go more in detail of this process, but this process has been heavily improved this year compared to last year. And basically, we passed from an activation time of, on average, 21 days to more or less 7 days, which is great for an emergency response, we believe. I already said that this is not a theory, this is a practice, this is something which is happening, but let me give you a few numbers from 2014. I have some numbers for 2015, but they are not yet implemented, whereas the numbers I'm going to give you are it's what happened in 2014, and these are consolidated data. So the little dots in the map shows the different locations where we operated. As you can see, the vast majority of the interventions happen in the southern and central part of Somalia, which is, as I was mentioning at the beginning, probably the regions of Somalia with the highest needs, but also with some other pockets of interventions in other areas of Puntland and Somaliland, which is basically the northern part of the country. In South Central Somalia, we targeted over 300,000 beneficiaries, which is more or less 89% of the total number of beneficiaries we targeted in 2014, with health, wash, nutrition, and emergency food security and livelihood. In Bosaso, in particular in Bari and Nugal, which is basically Bosaso and Garowe, we targeted over 35,000 beneficiaries, more or less 11% of the beneficiaries, with health, wash, nutrition, and emergency food security and livelihood. And finally, we had a very small component in Berbera last year, with a bit more than 700 individual beneficiaries, which is a 0.25% of beneficiaries with nutrition and cash transfers. I think this is, despite being a very small interventions in Berbera, it gives you a few an important hint, because it basically shows how we are able to respond also to the very localized to the very localized shocks that happen in Somalia. This what I was describing until now, it was the operational pillar of our early warning, early action system. At the same time, as I was showing you before, we have another pillar, which is the community early warning system, the community-based early warning system. This is a system that we are trying to develop together with the communities and for the communities. Basically, the objective is to build the community capacity to monitor some specific variable and therefore to anticipate shocks. This means that we are not identifying generalized triggers as we did for the operational part of the early warning, but we, together with the communities, we identify specific early warning indicators for specific communities. We also try to provide a structure for information sharing at community level and also between communities. We want to improve the community preparedness, and also we want to foster a risk prevention attitude and support the absorptive, adaptive, and transformative capacities of the various communities that we are looking at. Again, what is really relevant here, that this system is done together with the communities, for the communities themselves, based on the thorough analysis of the context, on the attributes of resilience, if you want, of the specific communities that we are looking at. This, of course, increases ownership, of the communities that we are targeting, and of course, it should guarantee a certain level of sustainability in the long run. The process that we are trying to implement basically goes into four, if you want, five steps. The first one is the participatory identification of key variable, and this one was done. Basically, it was a thorough community process, which led us to the identification of the key shocks, the key vulnerabilities, the key possible shocks and the key vulnerabilities of the single communities. This was a process which took place last year. It basically lasted around 6 months, 7 months. It was very detailed, because we spent an average of 9 days per community. And it entails the use of specific tools for guiding a little bit the discussion with communities. What we have is the outcome of this process was really a thorough identification of the possible hazards for the communities, to the level, for example, of having identified for one specific communities, and this we would never have thought about that one of the biggest risk for the community itself was the presence of crocodiles in the river. This is maybe a marginal example, but it gives you really the idea of the level of details that this process gave us. The second point, because this one is done as well, the establishment of early warning committees. Basically, for each communities, we have created or we have reinforced existing committees. And within these big committees, we created some subgroups which look specifically on early warning variables, which we look on early warning variables, basically. The step three and four are things which are happening now or that will happen in the future. And the first one is, of course, the selection of an appropriate technology platform for disseminating information. We are looking at mobile SMS systems or use of radios. This is something we are exploring at the moment. And also, we are looking at some training modules for selected community members, of course, meaning the early warning committees, to train these committees in the collection of data about the specific variables that we have identified. Finally, of course, we'll go through a system of to a period of testing of the system, and then, of course, the step five, it will be the full adoption of this system in the next month. If you want, and with this I really conclude because I think I spoke a bit too much. What we are looking at is a system whereby communities monitoring their own context and a system where the communities adopt and choose their own triggers. A system where the information is shared within the communities and possible between or among the communities. And also a system which is fully owned by the communities. So a system which doesn't necessarily activate a humanitarian response, but that activates a response of the communities itself. Let's, for example, imagine a communities which lives on the side of the river, of course, simplifying. If we put in place a system whereby the communities are able to monitoring the level of the river, at some point they will be able autonomously to move the earth to a certain distance to the river, because they realize that the level of the river is growing. Or even better, they might receive from another community the information that the level of the river is growing, and therefore they should take an action from that. With this, I really finish my presentation. I hope it was interesting, and I'll be happy to answer 20 questions and also to listen to any of your comments or suggestions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, John. I think it was a really interesting presentation. I have a lot of questions for you, and I think a couple of my colleagues probably do too, but it would be great to maybe open it up to Arian, and it looks like she might already be typing in a question. I think we lost Wilbrod along the way. But Arian, if you have any questions for John, if you'd like to kick us off. John, are you able to see Arian's question?
John, it seems we're having some trouble hearing you. Maybe there was a mic issue after you muted and then unmuted? I'm not sure.
Can you hear me?
Yes, now we can hear you.
Okay, good. Okay, so if you I am talking, so if you don't hear me, let me know. Okay,
Will
good.
do. Can you hear me
Basically.
loud and clear?
Okay, good. Basically, I see that Ariane question is how long was the community process? No, I didn't state that the process was 7 days. The community process in total took over 6 months, not days, over 6 months, with an average of 9 days per communities repeated twice. In fact, what we notice is that we did the first round of the process, and we realized that the level of information was okay, but was not arriving at the depth that we were expecting. Therefore, we reviewed a little bit the process and we redid it again. So in total, this whole process took around 6 7 months, and actually it was quite challenging because it's something that was never done to this step in Somalia, at least to this scale, because it was challenging because our team, it was not trained for doing this kind of process. So there was a learning curve that we needed to basically needed to have. I should also probably mention that we are planning to review this process on a yearly basis. So in a couple of months, so exactly at the same time of the year, more or less, we will do another round of consultation in the communities to verify if which was actually the impact of the activities that we have been implemented, and also to verify if the plans that we established last year, they are still valid. I hope I answered to your question, Arianna.
I had a question, I think, building off from Ariana's second point, which is when you get to the activation mechanism slide, you're talking about how the process of the response process, once the donors had gotten together and with the information that you had provided and decided to respond using the IRF, that it took about 7 days, which was down from. And I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit more about that process and sort of how you reduced that time and sort of what the internal mechanisms are for convening that meeting with the donors and how you make decisions about when and whether to allocate the IRF mechanism funding.
I also had some interruptions in the microphone, but I hope I got the question. Basically, if I understood it well, is how it was possible to reduce the activation process from 21 days to 7, and how this basically 7 days works. Is it correct?
That's correct.
Okay, good. Yes. The first side of the question is how it was possible to reduce the timing from 21 to 7 days. This basically was a learning process for us, and it was a learning process for the donor. What was happening last year is that the DFID had this internal risk facility, which was activated each time there was a shock. So each time there was a shock, we were going through a process whereby we were identifying the shock, identifying the triggers, proposing some reactions, writing a concept note, sending the concept note to DFID. The DFID sends us back questions. We respond to the questions. The project is approved. Basically, this takes it's if you want, it was a kind of a normal project approval process. Maybe more compressed than the normal one, but it took an average of 21 days. What we did this year with DFID, basically, it was the establishment of a sort of a framework agreement whereby they allocate the entire sum for emergency to us, or actually 75% of the emergency funds to us, and we basically activate the use of these funds on the basis of a meeting. Basically, what happened is that once there is a shock, there is basically communication to what we call the decisional panel, which is formed by some BRICS members plus DFID itself, and if there is a general perception that the triggers are real or the need is real, basically there is this happened in 24 hours. Basically, after 24 hours, basically more information are provided in a structured way within 48 hours, and then the decision about the approval or not of the emergency response is done in a meeting, which happens basically 2 days after. So the total sum of the period is 7 days. And this is the most important thing. Basically, instead of going back to DFID, etc., what happens is that this decisional panel takes the ultimate decision on how and if and how to use the funds.
Thanks, Sean.
Sorry, there's
Sorry,
one there, but
Nicole.
I can ask them.
Okay, Arian, we'll go to your other question, and then I think that we have a couple of questions in DC. So Jean Arian's other question, as you see on the bottom of the screen, is how do you keep the early warning committees, the community early warning committees engaged?
Yeah. Yes, I see the question. As I said, this is something we are establishing. I mean, the committees are now established. We will do the training in the next few weeks, and then the process will go on. But we actually realize this is the biggest challenge. However, we think that this is part of a process where, again, for the first time in Somalia, I realized that this is not, I'm not pretending that this is the first time everywhere. This has been done for years in many other places, but for Somalia, it was the first time. The communities have a heavy and direct involvement in the project itself. So we hope that this direct involvement also produces a sort of modification in the way they see things and they see the relationship with us basically. And they also realize that a community early warning system is beneficial for them. Basically, the discussion that we had is do you really need a system like this one? Can be useful for you? Now, it's true that for sure there is a component of hoping to get some more humanitarian aid from that, but I also believe that there is a genuine idea that this kind of system can be helpful to the communities. Unfortunately, until now, all of this is theory. We are going to test the system in the next few months, as I was saying. But and here I would throw back the question to you. If you have suggestions or experience from other locations, they are really most than welcome.
Just to respond to your question very briefly, John, and the context is a little bit different, so it might not apply so easily or so directly in Somalia, but one of the ways that I've seen some projects try to keep the communities engaged, in particular if you're working in a context where there hasn't been a shock, is to try to link the depending on the kinds of community level indicators you're using, to try to link the communities who are collecting those indicators to other stakeholders who have a use for them, so that the demand for the information isn't only for responding to a potential disaster. For example, in some of the areas where other donors have implemented a project-level early warning element, the communities might collect information on rainfall levels or market prices, and that information is very useful for people doing food security programming or response, but it's also useful to other entities like national or regional meteorological services who don't have the resources to be able to place rain gauges in a representative manner across all parts of a country. I know that might not apply so directly for Somalia, but it certainly would for East Africa regionally. Others are like central statistics offices or the ministries that are in charge of trade tend to be very interested in commodity prices for key commodities in specific markets, but don't necessarily have the resources themselves to be able to go out and regularly collect that information. So one of the ways that I've seen projects try to keep communities engaged is to generate demand for the information outside of a food security response context. So you're using the information for multiple purposes across stakeholders who might have other needs for it. I know that's not necessarily so easily done in Somalia, where you're working with a failed state. So you might end up looking at other actors. I know projects tend to, I know you were saying you use information from OCHA and FuseNet and FSNAU to try to triangulate information you're getting from the communities. I also imagine that those institutions would very much like to have information that's coming from those communities as well, because if you typically when you're working in these kinds of environments, these are among some of the most vulnerable to food insecurity, the communities most vulnerable to food insecurity. So there is often a demand for that level of information from larger agencies who just don't have the capacity to get down to that level of detail in their information collection. So those are just a couple of ideas, and it would probably take a little bit of refinement to find ways to make them that more applicable in the Somalia context. But that's one thing to think about.
Can I just comment on that briefly, very briefly?
Absolutely.
Yeah, no, basically what I want to mention, yes, that it's very correct that the Somalia context, unfortunately, often doesn't allow this kind of connections, being a failed state, actually. So not having structured institutions at federal level. What we are discussing basically is to link up this our system basically to the local DMA. The DMA is the Disaster Management Authority in Somalia, which works under the Ministry of Interior, and that is trying to open local offices in the various regions of Somalia. So this is a discussion which is ongoing with the complexity of working in Somalia, where you really don't have strong institutions of referral, basically.
Yeah. I think it's a great first step, though, and especially if there are other donors working to strengthen the capacities of the DMA within the Ministry of the Interior so that you're not just pushing information to another entity that can't use it. I'm going to step off the platform and cede it to another colleague. Meredith, do you have any questions? You've been waiting very patiently.
Sure. Thanks so much for the presentation. It's really interesting. I'm curious what sorts for the early warning community committees, I'm curious what sorts of information that you're going to train them to collect and how they will interpret it in order to predict these potential disasters.
Yes. As I said, we are looking to a very, very localized system. So the variables, the indicators that we are looking at are really decided by the communities themselves. And also we are very well aware that we are not working in vacuum. The communities we are working with have already their own informal early warning systems, and therefore we will try to link up the indicators that we collect to these already existing systems. Just make you an example. Basically, we tried to have a discussion with one specific community just to test. And for this community, basically, one of the most relevant possible assets that we have identified together with them, it was the river itself, and the possible flooding that quite regularly was happening. And together with them, basically, we identified a few some very simple ways to identify to allow them basically to identify the risk. Basically, after several discussions, we discovered that there was a specific stone that was inside the river that, when was covered, is indicating the fact that possibly a flood is happening. Some other elders were mentioning some particular behavior of some specific birds, imagine. So these are the very specific kind of indicators that we are looking at. They have to be simple. They have to be things that the communities themselves know already, and they are very much able to monitor and to check. Another simple things that we will look at for sure, it will be the price of some key commodities. Again, key commodity, of course, the main key commodities are rice, sorghum, etc., but in some specific location, maybe others are also relevant. And therefore, what we look together with these communities is basically to have a big piece of paper in the community center, whereby every week someone was writing the price of that specific commodity. And then, of course, if they would see an increase of the price, this would be a signal for them that maybe it's time to start selling if you have some stocks, or actually to start preparing to consume less of that specific item. Of course, considering that not everybody is literate. So, for instance, with this community, some suggestion it was to use some symbols which were agreed within the communities. I hope I answered to the question.
Yeah, that was great. Thank you.
Jean, I have another question for you, and it's on the second to the last slide when you were talking about some of the how you're involving the community in the project and what you're hoping that the community is able to take away from the project, including a community ability to identify and respond to shocks. I'm wondering if the program is also making any effort to strengthen community capacities to be able to reach out to other actors when the magnitude of the shock surpasses their ability to respond, or sort of what the next step is if the community is doing its own monitoring and does see that the situation is deteriorating, but the response that the shock requires is beyond their capacities. If the project is working to strengthen community connections to other response entities, the disaster management authority gets up and running, or other NGOs or donors working in Somalia, is there any effort to try to do that, or any plan for how communities should proceed if what they're seeing is beyond their capacity?
My answer would be yes, but yes, because it's something we are looking into. We are well aware that some of the shocks that will happen will overcome the capacities of response of the specific communities. So yes, we are looking to for now to keep them linked up to our system, to the IRF, which anyway will go through the next, I would say, 3 4 years minimum. And then we will slowly moving in a more formalized way of linking up or linking them up to a broader system. I mentioned before the DMA, and this is one of the reasons we are looking into the DMA. Basically, if we manage to effectively engage these specific institutions, assuming that this specific institution will be established in the specific regions and districts we are looking at, this could be a way to connect them to a broader system of humanitarian response. So this is the first leg of my answer. Then there is the but. And the but is that, unfortunately, Somalia is a context where humanitarian's responses follow to humanitarian's responses that follow to other humanitarian responses. Therefore, unfortunately, we have created a system of incentives whereby communities look at us as first resort, not as last resort. And we really would like to break a little bit this circle, because it's totally non-sustainable. And we think that it will be less and less sustainable with the year passing, basically, considering that already the amount of resources devolved to humanitarian aid is shrinking, considering the fact that other emergencies are, I don't know if unfortunately or fortunately, but they are at the top of the agenda of the humanitarian community. And Somalia will be less and less within the humanitarian compass, basically. Over.
Thanks, John. I think, yeah, that's Somalia is a particularly challenging context in that regard. So, but I think your idea of trying to strengthen community capacity to be able to feed into the project's own emergency response facility is a great start, because it allows communities to become more conversant in how NGOs make decisions about the kinds of shocks they're going to respond to and how they're going to respond. And all of that will do nothing but help the communities who are able to sort of absorb that and become more comfortable with that sort of a process, to then be able to translate it to either other NGOs or the DMA or other stakeholders who might look to respond in different situations.
May I answer briefly to this
comment?
One last
question. Yes, of course.
I would say that this is, unfortunately, this is the least of our preoccupation. Often in Somalia, maybe a bit cynically, we talk about professional beneficiaries. They really know what we expect. They really know what to say. They really know how a project works. They really know how a project is activated. This is not the problem. They know exactly how the system works, and they know how to use the system, basically. And this is a very rational behavior, because this is what was happening for years. So there was a crisis, and then humanitarian response was happening. So of course, a rational response to that would be to learn how the humanitarian community works and use this humanitarian community to respond to this emergency. Now it's still a little bit possible, but increasingly it will not be possible because resources are shrinking. So we have to break a little bit this circle, I would say. I just make you an example. I was mentioning before the community process and how we were forced basically to do a first round and then a second round of community process. And one of the main reasons why we need to redo the community process, it was because the first round, basically, we had the responses that we would have expected to have. They basically knew exactly what we would have expected. And they told us exactly what we would expect it. Basically, I think this is an achievement, and is not yet fully achieved, if you pass me this wrong use of words. But The achievement is basically the fact that we manage to convince the communities that we are working with that this is different, and that we can go beyond the normal or traditional or the usual way of doing humanitarian interventions in Somalia. Really, the first round it was an amazing collection of traditional interventions that we would have done, from digging a borehole to do some cash transfers. The second one was a little bit different. Over.
One last question from my end, and then we'll go around to see if anyone else has any other questions before we let you go on your way, since we know it's getting quite late for you. I was wondering if, when we were talking again about the activation mechanism for the IRF, there, you know, it starts with the community information kind of triangulated with information provided by other entities. And I'm wondering if you, how often is information sort of fed into the system by all of those entities? Is it done on a monthly basis, on a biweekly basis, on some other periodicity? Is it ad hoc? I mean, obviously, it can't be fed up from the communities until the community collection structures exist. But how often are you looking at these trigger indicators within your program for the IRF, and how often are you then also filtering in community information?
Okay, the system that the FSNU and the HCT they are trying to put in place, in theory, we look at a monthly delivery of information. This is not happening. Therefore, we have a quarterly report, some monthly follow up, and then some ad hoc publication in case something is happening. For example, last year there were some pockets of droughts, and there was actually a weekly dissemination of information by these big entities. This is the, I would say, the formal part of the collection of information. In terms of the informal part, I would say it's ongoing. Here we are talking about five organizations which have their feet strongly anchored to the ground. We have people on the ground that work with the communities on a daily basis. So we have a daily formal and equally important, I would say, informal transfer of information that arrives to us. Of course, there are some kind of shocks which are basically identified by everybody, because they are quite big, so they are quite easy to see. But there are some localized one that basically we see because we are there. I'm talking about some specific floods, for instance, in Kismayo, we had last year and as well this year, which basically we identified. They were very much localized, but nonetheless, they displaced over 700 households. So we are talking about a few thousand people, but which was not captured, at least at the beginning, by the different reports, which we were able to basically capture and tackle because we are working in these places.
Does anybody else, either online or in the room, have any questions for Jean before we let him go for his evening? All right, Arian, thanks so much.
I didn't get the question, sorry.
Sure, no problem. Arian just typed the question in at the bottom of the chat box on whether you might have a specific example of early warning use by a pastoralist community or communities with livestock keeping as a predominant livelihood.
Yes, okay. You mean specific responses to this shock or the activation? Okay, so responses to the shock, I understand. Yes, we do. We do, and we have several examples. Basically, we are targeting different livelihood groups, and among these, we are also targeting pastoralist communities. Now, if I have to be completely honest, I don't remember the specificities for these communities, but for sure we responded to some shocks that basically hit these kind of communities. If you want, I can look at a few things, but and come back to you. In general, I would say that two main things were relevant. No, actually, sorry, it came back into my mouth, to my mind. Two main things. First one, it's basically animal health. So we went through some vaccination or cure campaign for the animals, as well as some education, some trainings for the pastoralists themselves on how to use the livestocks themselves. Second and biggest component of these responses is cash. I would say that cash deserves a specific attention because it's the most flexible, the most democratic way to respond to this because you give the full freedom to these communities to choose what basically they need to respond to the shock. If they want to complement their food basket, for example, if you want to increase their herds, it's really depends. Of course, this was done because in the location we were looking at, there was a market which was running, which was existing. The stocking, it's a very complicated issues in Somalia. It was discussed partially by us, but it was widely discussed by our members in other contexts or by different members. The first reaction of the community is a big no. Because herds are, for the pastoralist, herds are considered as the richness, the wealth of the communities themselves. Therefore, giving up to the herds would mean giving up to the wealth of the households and of the communities itself. Nonetheless, there are a few a few positive examples of the stocking. Done by some organization, not particularly by us. I would say not by us because we were talking about not, for example, not big high-level droughts, but pockets which could have dealt in a few months. Or even by floodings that was killing, that killed some part of the livestock. So it was more restocking than livestocking. But there were cases of destocking, which were examples that were quite complicated to implement. It's famous in Somalia, the example of one pastoralist in a region of southern Somalia who, after 2011, decided to sell his livestock basically and to procure a truck with the money that he made. And with the truck, then he was moving the stocks, the livestock of his community to other locations. And this, of course, was a very successful example of a person that basically created from a crisis the opportunities. I mean, he found himself in the necessity of destocking, and then from the stocking, he created an opportunity, a great opportunity of business. But this is really an exception more than normality.
All right. Well, with that, John, I think we will say thank you very much, and let you prepare to go on about your evening. We will have the full recording of the presentation available, probably, and the notes from the presentation within about a day or so. It'll be on our website, and we'll send it around to the listserv for those who were trying to get to us today but just couldn't for one reason or another. Similarly, Jean, if you have questions for the interest group as your work to implement the community early warning element starts to really hit the ground, please feel free to reach out, and we'll tap into all of our members to see if they might be able to provide you with some ideas based on their own experiences. And we'll definitely look forward to hearing how your work progresses in the months ahead.
Thank you very much. Really interesting, and I am very much looking forward to further discussion in the next few months. As I said, it's something we are testing, and we will try to implement in the next few months. For sure, there will be other chances to discuss. Thank you all.
Great. Well, we look forward to hearing it, John. Thank you so much for your time. Thanks, Arian and Donard, for hanging in there with us on the remote platform, and to Meredith for joining us in person. We look forward to talking to you all again at the September meeting, currently planned for September 10th at the same time. We'll reach out with a little bit of additional information on the highlights of that meeting in the next couple of months. So we look forward to seeing you again in the fall.